Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Survival, written by Stuart Diver and read by Christopher Pitman and Roger Cardwell.
I'm fast asleep. From somewhere in my subconscious comes a rumbling sound. It's growing louder. Louder. It's roaring. My eyes shoot open. Is this one of those thrilling winds that tear down the valley? No, this is something far more frightening. A hailstorm? An explosion? A bomb? The thoughts flash through my mind. My body is shaking, uncontrollably shuddering. Sally awakes. Our flat is moving all around us. Everything's rattling, crashing down. I hear the window being smashed in. I hear the glass shatter, showering us on our bed. Instinctively, I lift my head off the pillow to see what's happening. It's dark. Nothing makes sense. The wall behind us comes crashing down on our bed. My head is forced back down as the roof caves in on top of us. I can feel the ceiling about 3 centimetres in front of my face. I'm choking on dust. I can't breathe. I'm coughing, choking. I can't see a thing. I've got to get us out. Where? I roll off the bed and try to find the window. I land on broken glass, slashing at my hands and knees. I blindly feel around for a way out, but there's no room, no escape. It's pitch black. I climb back onto the bed, and Sal's screaming and screaming. It's okay, Sal. It's okay. We'll be all right. And she's screaming. I'm pinned. I can't feel anything from the waist down. It's all right, Sal. We'll be okay. And I reach out to touch her. She's still under our doona. I run my hand down the shape of her body and find a big concrete beam across her waist. I move my hand up to her face and she's screaming again. I can't lift my head! My head is pinned! Her head's trapped by the bedhead. There's so much noise. It begins as a rumble and blocks out everything else as it hits. And a rush of freezing water. Both of us are screaming, blood-curdling, terrifying screams, and the water cascades down onto us. It swirls around us, rising and rising, and I'm holding Sally's face. I can't shift the bedhead off her. It's not budging. I'm trying. Oh, God, I'm trying to move it. The water's absolutely freezing. It takes my breath away as it bites into my semi-naked body, and the air is thick with dust. My mouth fills with it. I'm choking. Sal, it's okay. We're going to be okay. It's okay. We're going to be all right. And she's screaming, Stuart! Stuart! At the top of her voice, Stuart! 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 Over and over and over again. The water's flying around us. And I put my hand over Sal's mouth. I've got to stop the water getting in. It's rising, rising. It's useless. I can feel the water seeping between my fingers, filling her mouth. I've got to stop the water, please. I've got to stop the water. And it floods in. I can't stop it. She's gurgling. Drowning as her lungs fill up. My hand is still over her mouth. I can feel her face, contorted. The screaming has stopped. I feel the life drain out of my wife's body. She goes limp. I can't see her face, but I know it's a mask of sheer terror. I take my hand away. I feel so useless, helpless, totally, completely, and utterly unable to do anything. I feel so small, so insignificant. I'd always thought that I had the ability to protect Sal. I can't anymore. But I must survive. Nothing I can do for Sal. I must try to save myself. I arch my back, using my elbows to push myself above the water. Mud and water flow around me. My mouth is just out of the water. There's a tiny gap between my mouth and the roof. A tiny pocket of air. At least I can breathe. The water laps at my lips. I must keep pushing myself up. And part of me wants to just drop. The water can take me too. It's taken my wife. Take me too! I just want to be with Sal. The walls feel like they're closing in. The roof is getting closer. Get me out of here. No control. I'm constrained. I can hardly move. And the water flows away. It all just took 30 seconds. 30 seconds that keep replaying in my mind over and over again. The details as vivid now as the night it happened. 30 seconds that changed my life forever and took the lives of 18 other people. One of them, my reason for living. My wife, Sal. 30 seconds earlier, we'd been safely tucked up in bed. Bimberdeen Lodge had been our home, our haven. It had now become our tomb. Thredbo has been like a second home, more or less, ever since I was born. I know this place. I know its beauty. I now know its terror. It was the night of July 30, 1997. Sal dying in my hands will stay in my mind forever. I'll take that memory to the grave. I met Sally Donald during our first year at the Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology. Sally was like no other girl I'd met before. Apart from her natural beauty, there was just something about her. She had this infectious smile. When she smiled, everyone smiled. That was the effect she had. But as far as I was concerned, Sal was way beyond my reach. Far too beautiful to be on my arm. I've never in my entire life asked a girl out because I'm unbelievably shy. And the girls I went out with all asked me. Even Sal asked me to go out. I never had the self-confidence to do it. We started going out at the end of the first year of uni. As usual, it wasn't me who made the first move. Finally, Sal said, "What are you doing? I would like to go out with you." So I just replied, "Oh, okay, that sounds good." Wow, going out with a slim, beautiful blonde girl. On our first date, we went to the Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology's Wild Child Ball at the Melbourne Town Hall. We kicked on to a dingy nightclub in Toorak, and in the end, we were sitting on a couch down the back in the dark, and Sal said, "Are you going to kiss me, or do I have to kiss you?" Fumbling along, I replied, I think you have to kiss me." That was the first move, and it blossomed from there. 9 weeks after our first date, I moved into Sal's house. We were besotted with each other, and it seemed the natural thing to do. Mum wasn't hugely impressed. "Look, you're only 20, you don't know what you're talking about." And I said, "Mum, this person is unbelievably special, and this is the person I want to live with." She wasn't happy at all, but Dad, who is probably the stricter Catholic, kept telling her, "It's not a problem, don't worry about it, there are no dramas, just let him go, he'll work it out. If he screws up and comes back, he's the one who's going to get hurt." So off I went. It was the first time I'd had any major disagreement with my mother, but considering my extensive life experience, I thought I was king of the world. It had just simply felt like it was the right thing to do. Sal and I had been living in each other's pockets and formed a very strong relationship very quickly. Sal was still living at home with her sister Anna and mother Margie. Sal's dad, Andrew, had just moved out, so I became man of the house. I had always this inbuilt desire to help others that wanted or needed help, and perhaps that's the way I viewed Sal's family. So it was Sal, her sister, her mum, and I in a fairly big house out in Research on the outskirts of Melbourne. I felt at home there. I instantly became very close to the three of them. Sal and I had separate bedrooms, so we had to sneak back and forth in the middle of the night. After 8 months, I bought Sal a double bed for her 21st birthday, and that was the end of separate bedrooms. Sal's mum turned a blind eye. Sally gave me my confidence. She made me realise that I wasn't as ugly as I thought I was. She gave me some direction in my life, made me start making decisions. But most important of all, Sal taught me how to cry. It was the first time in my life I'd ever had any dealings with anyone really outwardly emotional, a person who actually openly cried. We never did that. We were too tough, we divers. We didn't have much outward display of emotion. Sal and her sister cried a lot more than I had ever experienced people crying before. It was just their way of dealing with situations. They'd have a 2-minute cry and that would be the end of that. In the beginning it scared me because I'd think, "I've never seen anyone crying, what are they crying about? I must have done something really bad." Then I realised it had nothing to do with me at all. It was just their way of displaying emotion. Despite Mum's resistance to my moving out of home, my parents quickly came to love and accept Sal. She was bright, intelligent, and always seemed to be smiling and laughing. She could hold a good discussion and she made everyone feel comfortable in her presence, especially me. Since I lost her, I've spent many hours with her parents, Margie and Andrew, remembering everything that we loved so much about her. Right from a little baby, she was a beautiful blonde girl with lovely blue eyes and an ever-present smile. She was extremely popular and charming and always had a lot of friends. A person who really enjoyed everything that she did, enjoyed the people she was with. But what most attracted me to her was that she was so different from me. She offered a challenge to me in so many ways. That was a crucial part of our relationship. She was a quiet type, while I was the original noisy boy. so we complimented each other. And here I was trying to drag her outdoors, and she was teaching me how to sit down and enjoy reading a book on the lounge. I was a challenge to her, and she, in return, presented a challenge to me. Everyone told me Sal wasn't an outdoor sort of person. I proved them wrong. I managed to get Sal and his sister Anna out onto the slopes and taught them both how to ski. I can still picture Sal's face beaming from beneath her beanie and sunglasses. I'm just so glad I got to share so much of my life with her, and we packed so much into the short time we had together. I know I can't ever bring Sal back, but my second greatest love can't be taken away from me that easily, my love affair with the mountains. I'd be lying if I told you I could remember the first time I came to Thredbo, but Mum keeps reminding me. I was 8 weeks old, perched in a backpack carrier as she carted me to the top of South Ram's Head, which is one of the big peaks. I was 2.5 when I first walked to the top of Mount Kosciuszko. I was 5 when I carried my first overnight pack and did my first 3-night walk. The mountains are in my blood. And when I drive into Thredbo, I feel so comfortable, like I'm coming home. It's hard for most people to understand that feeling, considering how much Thredbo has taken away from me. My parents, Steve and Annette, are Scottish. They had it pretty tough growing up. It was the end of the war. They both came from big families and had few luxuries. They lived in Glasgow and used to brave the misty, cold Scottish weather to go walking or skiing in the Highlands. Dad drove a scooter and Mum perched on the back carrying the skis as they slid down the ice-covered roads. They married in Scotland and honeymooned on the back of a Lambretta scooter touring Switzerland and Austria. A year later, they decided to make Australia their home. When they got here, it opened a whole new world for them. Big open spaces, mountains to climb, fresh air to breathe, and it was warmer. Paradise compared to what they were used to. They made Melbourne their home. It didn't take long for them to find people with the same interests in the outdoors. They joined the Youth Hostels Association, and on Friday afternoons would head off into the hills with other outdoor enthusiasts. Somewhere along the line, they found time to have a family. First, they had my brother Ewan, and 2 years later, on the 14th of January 1970, I was born at the Holy Cross Hospital in Geelong, Victoria. My mother says it was a difficult birth and pretty long labour. From an early age, it was always Ewan and I against the world. He's always been my big brother, always protective. If I got into fights or broke my arm, which I did 5 times when I was a kid, he was usually the one there to drag me home and make sure I was okay. In many ways, he's still there to get me out of scrapes. I was a handful as a child, never sat still, always running about, driving everybody crazy, always trying to do things bigger, better and faster. Even from an early age, I had no problem with my own company. I could quite easily go into the backyard and play in the sandpit for 3 hours by myself. I loved digging holes and building huge monstrosities. If we were up at the snow, I would go and build a snowman 3 times larger than I was. I always had to be doing something and enjoyed spending time by myself. And that developed even more as I got older. While my parents always made sure they gave us love, attention and anything else we needed, they didn't let us rule their lives. They were always there for us and provided us with opportunities that they never ever would have dreamt of having themselves, yet they never lost sight of their own dreams. What they did was include us in those dreams. My parents were always employed, so we always had money, but instead of spending it on material assets, they took us travelling. As far back as I can remember, the mountains straddling the New South Wales-Victoria border were our backyard. Although we lived in Geelong, and later North Fitzroy, they were simply our addresses. Our home was the high country. Every weekend, Mum and Dad would pack up the combi and off we'd go. It was what they lived for. From my earliest days, it created a very, very strong bond. I was 3.5 when I first put skis on. It was at Mount Hotham in Victoria. And back then, my parents could never see the point of buying lift tickets, so we used to pull up in the combi about 3 kilometres from the main resort. We'd jump out, put our boots on, and walk all the way up the hill. And at the top, we'd strap the skis on and ski down, fall over, do a couple of turns, get up. It didn't matter what the weather was like. Sometimes it was raining and we'd be out skiing. We'd complain, "Mum, what are we doing skiing in the rain?" And she'd answer in a Scottish accent, "Och, in Scotland it's like this every day." That would be it, away we'd go. At the time, I thought it was hell on earth, but looking back on it now, I realise it was a fantastic challenge and learning experience. I remember my first pair of skis. A family friend, Phil Pilgrim, made them out of wood, and I thought they were the hottest things known to man. If it was really icy, I had to get the Swiss Army knife out at lunchtime and recarve the edges, because they'd become rounded and wouldn't cut through the ice. And Phil, his wife Sheila, and their daughters Sarah and Joanne would often come away with us. They had the same love for the outdoors. And skiing for us was on a shoestring budget. We used to camp out every time. Falls Creek, Thredbo, wherever we went, we camped out. We used to park the combi and set up the tents at the bottom of Crackenback Chairlift in Thredbo or at the Thredbo diggings just down the road. I never had any idea that there were lodges in Thredbo and you could stay in them. We used to cook in the combi and eat in the tents. We would go skiing and, if it was raining, at the end of the day, we would go to the bistro at Thredbo for a couple of hours, draping our wet ski gear over the heaters. And when they had dried out a bit, it was back to the combi and the tents. Sometimes during the school holiday.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.